Welcome to our online service of First Baptist Church Salisbury. We welcome members of the First Family online this morning. To those of you that have come across this website, this live stream today, perhaps by accident, perhaps someone directed you here, we welcome you also. Coming into the parking lot this morning, I met a young man who was looking for a place to worship today. Now, it grieves a pastor's heart to have to turn anybody away from a worship service, but I directed him to our website, said there would be a link to this live stream, so I hope that perhaps he is watching. He shared a very vivid personal testimony of how the Lord changed his life, and so we welcome everyone, because if you're a believer, if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, you have it in your heart to worship with other believers, so we are thrilled that you are gathering with us online this morning. If you think that just because we're not able to meet together for worship during this time, that is the end of being church and doing church and practicing a life of ministry together, you'd be wrong about that. We are working diligently, your church staff is, to provide many opportunities for learning and service and fellowship, albeit in different ways during this time together, a challenging time it is. There are many live stream options, online studies, a great cache of online material that we're making available to you. And remember that we are all still doing personal ministry, reaching out in love, encouraging one another, especially reaching out to those who are having a difficult time or special challenges during this crisis. Remember that even your church staff, your ministerial staff, we are not permitted to make hospital visits during this time, but we do want to be in contact as much as we can with people that are in the hospital by telephone, with their families. So please help us by sharing that information with us. And in the unfortunate event, if someone in your family is facing an end-of-life situation, the hospitals have shared with us that they might be willing to make some exceptions for your ministers during that time. If you'll just contact us, and please be very clear about your need and desire for how we might respond. I also appreciate the fact that our deacons are working to contact their families. So again, be in contact with your deacons if you have special needs that we can help you with. Now, here are some things that you need to know. Rod shared with me as I was driving into Salisbury this morning that he has enrolled already 250 people in the right now online media access availability that we have. If you're on our email list here at church, you should have received an email yesterday, I believe he said, that will give you a link, and you just click on that link and share information, and you will have access to a plethora of resources. He described it as Christian Netflix. It has entertainment, it has children's material, it has devotional material, inspirational material, as well as discipleship material. So follow that or call him if you have questions. That's a way for you to continue your Christian growth during this time. And then Brian wants to share that as of right now, plans are still a go for Caswell this summer. This is the time for youth to be signing up, getting deposits in. So that will be a great help to him if you will follow through on that. And we will see what the future has in store for the summer. Also, we want to encourage you. We don't have anything definite. And I'm not making a promise this morning, but we hope to have some sort of online prayer service available this Wednesday night. I'm working on that. I'm sure some folks here will be able to help me with that. But you'll be listening for updates about a possible live stream of a prayer service or some other way that we can gather together as a family of God and pray. And if that materializes, I hope to give you a chance to share with others encouraging verses that really bless you during these trying times. Thank you again for being here. We will worship the Lord together, and we will worship Him well this morning.
Good morning. I'm standing here in an empty First Baptist Church sanctuary, and that seems so strange to me. It was even stranger Wednesday night to be in our youth room and only a few youth there that were helping us with the live broadcast. I'm used to being able to meet with about 140 students each week between our church ministries and the church extension ministries to our Christian clubs on campus. But we're still going to try to reach out to students, do a lot of creative things over the next few weeks, and these ministry minutes are going to help. First of all, if you need to contact me, two great ways. My email, brian@fbcsalisbury.org, and my phone number, 704-798-3836. I'm using old school graphics like this because Russ and his folks have been working so hard, didn't want to add anything else extra for the video time. Secondly, I asked one of the students, how many Netflix videos can you watch while you're out of school? They responded with a lot, but let me give you some other options. Bible Project Videos tells you about all sorts of things on the Bible. A great, great resource, something you might learn on your downtime here. The other one, if you have questions about your faith, gotquestions.org is another great website. And finally, our church website, fbcsalisbury.org. You can do a lot of things. One thing you can do is sign up for Caswell and for our missions trip, because we're hoping by June it's a go. So you can go ahead and plan for that. Two other quick things. We have decided to do a Instagram Wednesday night youth worship service. It's live stream on Instagram and on Facebook for parents or for other older people. And so the Instagram, we're using Spencer's, which you see right here at spncr.c. Hoping to do it on mine also, which is Brian Says with a Z. And then finally, the Facebook page for it is our Facebook Oasis Student Ministries -FBC Salisbury. We want to be doing a bunch of different things, looking at doing some Zoom Bible studies and several other things. Text me if you don't get text from me already. Hit me up, look on the website, look on my Facebook page, and we'll keep meeting and growing as a student ministry during these strange days. As I said, these are strange days. Let's make them strangely wonderful in how we love one another. See you as soon as I can.
Greetings, First Facebook Baptist Church of Salisbury. Your pastor search committee has been continuing to pray that God will lead us to the right person at the right time, and that we'd know him when we see him. Over the past several weeks, we finished going through the 250 plus resumes that were either submitted or matched to us. Of these, two candidates initially rose to the top as ones that we thought that God was leading us to explore. We researched these two candidates, watched online sermons, had phone conversations with them, and then did a full committee FaceTime interview. Yes, we were practicing social distancing before it was the end thing. One of those candidates was a truly dynamic preacher, and the other candidate excelled in being very easily approachable, but neither seemed to us the right fit. What we learned from these was that God was showing us two different ends of the spectrum and would likely be leading us to someone who was somewhere in the middle or perhaps possessed both qualities. There was no unity from the committee with either of these two candidates. However, shortly after this, and actually even before we did the FaceTime interviews, a third candidate's name kept popping up. So we explored what we could learn about him, contacted him, and then this past weekend had a FaceTime interview. Before we did this interview, one of our members asked David Wisnett and John Carlton, the two of our committee who were on the previous pastor search committee when Kenneth was called, how they knew that it was right the last time. Their only answer was that it was obvious and unanimous, and that they had an excited peace about it. This past Sunday, after our FaceTime interview with the most recent candidate, when that was over, we looked at David and John and said, it felt like that, didn't it? So we are still early in our vetting process. Let me emphasize that. But if this one works out, let's just say that there are many evidences of God's hand along this path. Over the next several weeks, your pastor search committee will continue to dig deeper into this candidate. We've scheduled a time in the next couple of weeks for he and his family to visit the campus and to let our other ministers grill him, get to know him and have a chance to ask him some questions. We will definitely be listening to our other ministers' input as well. So in summary, we are not there yet. However, so far, with every step we take, we're growing more and more confident in this excited peace that we experienced after our initial interview. Some realities on timing. If he does end up being the one, and everything would run incredibly smoothly and quickly with the rest of the process, then we would still be at least 4 to 6 weeks out from calling our new senior pastor. Given what's currently going on with the coronavirus pandemic, it's more likely that we're at least a couple of months out. We will not and cannot make any decisions prior to being able to meet as a full congregational body together again. So for now, this too will be on hold. But in the meantime, please continue to pray for our committee and specifically for this man and his family as we and they together seek God's timing and his leading. And if you would join with me this morning, we'll get started with an opening prayer. Father, we thank you that you know our steps, that you know the steps that you have planned for us already. God, I just pray that you would continue to guide us along those steps, one step at a time, as we continue to seek your will for this church, your will for how we reach out into this community, and how you want us to be beacons of light for those in and around us here, to show them who Jesus Christ is. Open our hearts to hear from you this morning. It's in Jesus' name I pray these things. Amen.
Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. For I am the Lord your God who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you. Please join with us as we sing, I Am.
There's no space that his love can reach. There's no place that we can find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. Take me in with your arms spread wide. Take me in like an orphan child. Never let go, never leave my side. Storm.
been in a storm? Do you like storms? Are we going through a storm right now? Maybe not rain or snow or anything like that, but a storm maybe outside with a lot of different things going on in our lives, or maybe a storm inside. What I'd like to do is show you two different kinds of storms. Did you know that you could make a storm? So many of you have done this before. You have made a tornado in a jar. The very simple way to do that is take a jar and then with about half full of water and then pour just a drop or two of water in it, of liquid in it. Now sometimes you might want to put food coloring in it to make it stand out a little bit more, just a drop of food coloring in there. And then I'm going to put some glitter in there too. And it's going to remind us of the storms. Now, this is how you make it. You put the lid on the jar very tightly, and then you turn the jar up and shake it just like this. There's a tornado, a vortex, they call it, is right inside that jar. I'm going to use the same ingredients except for one, but I want to read a story right before that. Here's a story of a storm at sea. It's in the Bible. When Jesus got into the boat, his disciples followed him. Suddenly, a violent storm arose on the sea, so that the boat was being swamped by the waves. But Jesus was sleeping. So the disciples came and woke him up, saying, "Lord, save us, we're going to die." He said to them, "Why are you afraid, you of little faith? Then he got up and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. The men were amazed and asked, "What kind of man is this? Even the winds and sea obeys him." All right. Now, what I'm going to do is use the same elements, water, a jar, food coloring, glitter, but I'm going to add one thing different. And let's see what we can make out of this jar. I'll put the same amount of water in. And then I'll put some glitter in. And maybe several different colors of glitter. I'll put some silver in and some blue in and some gold in. And I'm going to put some of that same purple that we had in before in the other one. Now, I'm going to add something different this time. I'm going to do the very same thing with this jar as I did the other jar. I'm going to swirl it around. I'm going to turn it around and try to make a storm out of it. But it acts differently. It's almost not a storm jar, but a calming jar. A jar that I can watch when I get nervous and afraid. And it just means that I added something, one thing different. I think sometimes instead of trying to change the circumstances around us, we need to add something to our life, like I added glue to this bottle. Maybe Jesus is the glue we need to add to our life to take us from the storms to calm. Would you pray with me? Jesus, bring the calm over us. In the storms of our life, you be with us. Through our prayers, through our Bible reading, you remind us that you are the Lord of everything, storm or calm. Amen.
Raise him up to life again. What can heal the wounded soul What can make us white as snow? What can fill the emptiness? What can mend our brokenness? Brokenness. Mighty, awesome, wonderful is the Holy Cross, where the Lamb laid down his life to lift us from the fall. Mighty is the power of the cross. What restores our faith in God? What reveals the Father's love? What can lead the wayward home? What can melt a heart of stone? What can free the guilty ones? What can save and overcome?
My strength, my song, this cornerstone, this solid ground. From through the fiercest drought and storm, what heights of love, what depths of peace. When fears are stilled, when striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless state, his tears of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. On that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was paid. Here in the death of Christ I live.
Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we do thank you that you loved us so much that you sent your Son to die for us. And Lord, we know you still love us today. And as we are in the midst of this virus, we just ask that you protect each one, protect us all. And I know there's so many in our country, in our state, and in our city that will be losing their jobs, and we just pray for them. And we just ask that you be with us during this time in a very special way. Help us be able to sense your presence in a stronger way than we have before. Because, Lord, we know you love us and that you care for us. And as we come to a place in the service where we normally take up an offering, we just ask that those offerings that are coming in online or through the mail, that you will bless those offerings, multiply them, and use them to further your work here in Salisbury as well as around the world. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
This is the beginning of our week of prayer for our home mission offering, the North American Mission Board offering. We call the Annie Armstrong Easter offering in support of all the home missionaries and our mission effort here in North America. We were to have a guest speaker who is a missionary for the North American Mission Board today. That's another difference in what this coronavirus situation is making in our scheduling here. We're having to redo our preaching and the different thematic elements from week to week and adjust. Be praying for us in that. But give as you pray about the North American mission offering. Give as the Lord has blessed you and speaks to you. The needs of our missionaries continue on, perhaps more now than ever. They are needed where they are, ministering and witnessing, proclaiming and living out the gospel of Jesus Christ. I want to thank our worship team, our church staff. They are working long and hard hours adjusting to all of these differences, and particularly the worship team and staff for putting together this service together, our tech team, those that have appeared on camera today, but also those behind the scenes that you have not seen have made this possible. And your church appreciates your hard work, your efforts for this to happen today. I also want to thank Pete Bogle for the report from our pastor search committee. What an exciting report. Continue to pray for them. Continue to pray for the candidate that they continue to interview and work with. Again, ask that God will lead us all and direct us to His perfect will for our church family. Now, I've got to admit, preaching to a completely empty, there's just a few people here this morning, not more, maybe eight or nine are here counting myself this morning. It's different. There is energy when a crowd joins in a service together. And so those of you that are watching at home today, I want you to be praying for your pastor as I preach, that the Lord would energize me with His Holy Spirit, that I would be able to communicate well to you, because this is a different way of communicating than what we're used to. So pray for me and pray for this worship service together. Has this been a stressful week for you? That's probably a rhetorical question. Of course it has. People are stressed out about their physical health because of the virus. There's concern about losing jobs, and I've heard reports even this week from our church family and others around my life of people losing jobs. There's anxiety over losses in the stock market. These are challenging, faith-stretching days. Our scripture lesson today comes from Mark chapter 4. Jesus and His disciples had spent a very long, stressful day teaching by the lakeside. Some people, in looking at this scripture portion, might call it the longest day. Some scholars believe that that day went all the way from Mark chapter 3, verse 20, to chapter 5, verse 20. Jesus began that day teaching in Peter's home near the synagogue in Capernaum. There was conflict and in several directions as He taught there. Then He moved His teaching outside the house to the shore of the Sea of Galilee. And a large crowd followed, and even more came, it seems, so that there were so many people pressing against Jesus and His disciples that He had to get in a boat and push out from the shore. And then from the boat, He taught the people many wonderful parables, including the parable of the sower and the seed. Now the day is beginning to wane. It's drawing close to evening. And we pick up our scripture lesson in Mark chapter 4, verse 35. Mark 4, verse 35. That day when evening came, Jesus said to His disciples, "Let us go over to the other side. Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat, so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." Jesus had indeed experienced a tough day. A weary and exhausted Jesus needed some solitude from the crowds and some peace for his soul. Here's an example in this story of how Jesus was both fully God and fully man. He was so much a man that the day, the stressful day, exhausted him physically, emotionally, and he needed some rest. And so he fell sound asleep in the stern of the boat. As they were progressing across the lake, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, a storm suddenly blew up. This was nothing unusual on the Sea of Galilee. But notice that in spite of the violent storm, where was Jesus? He was in the back of the boat, fast asleep. Now, there's a great question here. The Bible doesn't answer it, but how was Jesus able to sleep in the midst of this violent storm? Perhaps he was so tired, so exhausted that his body just shut down and he was unaware of it. But there's another possible explanation as well. Did he have God's peace so fully in his heart that he was so much at rest, so peaceful, so confident that he just slept in spite of the storm because of the great peace that existed within him? While Jesus slept, the disciples panicked. They feared for their lives. The fact that the disciples were so fearful tells us a great deal about the nature of this storm. At least four of them were experienced fishermen. A storm would have been nothing new, nothing different to them. They'd seen and survived storms before. But this storm scared the living daylights out of them. In desperation, they woke Jesus up. They said to him, "Master, we're about to go under. Don't you care? Wake up. Take charge. Do something. Save us." Jesus, as he awoke, did not speak to the disciples directly. Instead, he got up and he spoke just three words: "Peace, be still." He spoke to the storm. And immediately the wind died down, Mark tells us, and the sea became as smooth as glass. There were no longer wind or waves, just a calm sea. And the storm ceased quicker than it came up. This story of Jesus calming the storm on the Sea of Galilee provides us a wonderful reminder today that God is in control. God is in control. Do you need to hear that this morning in these uncertain days? Our God is in control. I love what Warren Wiersbe says. In these verses, we go from a great tempest to a great calm because we have a great Savior. We go from a great tempest to a great calm because we have a great Savior. Do you have a great calm today? Do you have a great calm because you are in the boat with Jesus? He brings you His peace, His security to your life. Notice I'm asking this morning, are you in the boat with Jesus? Not is Jesus in the boat with you. Many have the wrong idea in our society that if you simply ask Jesus to ride along with you in your boat, that makes you a Christian. But that's not what the Bible teaches about true faith in Him. You don't ask Jesus to ride along with you as you do your own thing and go your own way. You ask Jesus to take control. You make it His boat. You sign over the deed of your boat to Him. Now, whose boat is it? It's His. Now, technically, in this story in Mark, this boat didn't belong to Jesus. But who took the initiative to say, come, let's go over to the other side? Jesus did. There was no doubt in this story about who was in control. They were going to the other side simply because Jesus said so. Now we can learn some valuable and practical lessons from this cruise gone wrong, if you will, on the Sea of Galilee. A very simple lesson is the lesson that in life, storms will come. Storms will come. How many hurricanes can you name? My parents were in Eastern North Carolina in 1954. Some of you older members of our congregation will remember what a hurricane is associated with that year. Hurricane Hazel, and it devastated Eastern North Carolina. Those of us that were in the Charlotte area in 1989 will never forget Hurricane Hugo, 31 years ago. Then just a few years after that, Hurricane Andrew in South Florida devastated that area. I remember going there on a mission trip after the hurricane to help in the rebuilding, and it looked like a war zone. You can't describe it adequately what the effect of that hurricane made on South Florida. We remember Katrina from 2005, other hurricanes since then, but you know what the reality is? As many hurricanes as you can remember, there are many more that we don't remember their names because storms come in life. They're just a part of normal life. Storms will come. And when storms happen, bad things will follow. This morning, as we think about a different kind of storm, a hurricane called COVID-19. Has that storm caught you by surprise? It's a reminder to us all that we're not in control, not nearly as much as we think we are. Are you prepared for this storm that we're facing? Now, I'm not talking about having enough groceries, having money in the bank, being in good physical shape. This morning, I want to ask, are you spiritually prepared to weather this storm? Are you spiritually prepared to weather the storm we're in? A TV news crew was filming the widespread destruction following Hurricane Andrew in South Florida. The camera panned the area where, amid the destruction and the debris, one lone house was still standing, and its owner was outside cleaning up in the yard, cleaning the debris. The newsman approached him and said, "Sir, why is it that your house is the only one still standing? How did you manage to escape the severe damage of the hurricane?" The man replied, "I built this house myself. I built it according to the Florida State Building Code. When the code called for 2x6 roof trusses, I used 2x6 roof trusses. I was told that a house built according to code could withstand the impact of a hurricane. I did, and it did. It could be that no one else around here followed the code." This was a man who understood in South Florida storms were coming. That was just the nature of the area in which he lived. All he could do was prepare for the storm. All he could do was to be ready. And we look at this story of the disciples and Jesus on the boat and the storm on the Sea of Galilee. And we ask the question, were the disciples ready? And you look at it at their response and you would say, well, no, they didn't know what to do in a storm of that magnitude, of that fury. Matthew even describes the storm with the Greek word seismos. And we immediately think of that word and we associate it with earthquakes, don't we? This was an earthquake of a storm for the disciples. But yet, in the middle of that earthquake of a storm, the disciples realized a second great truth from this story is that when storms come, we have someone on whom we can call. We have someone on whom we can call. Here's one of the great distinctives of Christianity. God is not somewhere out there, distant from us, unreachable, unknowable, and who is not impacted by what we're going through. God is here with us. The prophet Isaiah spoke about the promised coming Messiah, that they would call his name, what? Emmanuel, God with us. We need to remember and we need to affirm to a hurting world in fear this morning that no matter what, God sent his son Jesus, and through Jesus, God is with us today as we battle this virus. God is with us. Now, this story doesn't say that if we have Jesus in the boat with us, our lives won't get rocked. It doesn't mean that being in relationship with Jesus promises us perfect health, a wonderful marriage, that you won't get laid off from your job, that you won't, that you'll have a life without cares. This story doesn't promise us that we'll be protected from the virus. Even as Christians, we are still subject to the same adversities which others around us experience. The difference is we have a God on whom we can call, and he has promised never to leave us or forsake us. The message we need to take from this is that when the storms of life threaten us, we have a God who is ready and able to help his children. That someone who will help us is Jesus, who is with us here today. When you retitle the boat of your life in his name, he has promised never to leave you or forsake you. In seafaring life, who's the last one usually to get off the ship? The captain. And there's a saying associated with that. If the ship goes down, who goes down with the ship? The captain goes down with the ship. I want you to hear me this morning, and I want you to affirm in your own soul that Captain Jesus isn't going to abandon you when the going gets tough. He's there with you, come what may in this life. He is faithful. He will walk with us through this life all the way into the life to come. Thank God for such a Savior, our Savior, Jesus Christ. There's a third lesson here. That is, Jesus has the power to calm every storm. He has the power to calm every storm. What did he say to the storm? Peace, be still. Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. Three words is all it took from the mouth of Jesus. And it wasn't the number of words that was important. What was important was the power of the one who was speaking the words. In fact, in the Greek, Jesus didn't need three words. There were only two. What he said was, peace, muzzled. And the wind and the waves obeyed his command. Do you know the presence and power of Jesus in your life today? Jesus may not immediately muzzle the virus around us, but he does speak peace to our hearts today. Is his calming presence real to you, so palpable you can feel it, you can touch it almost within your very soul? I pray that his presence is known by you this morning. The writer of Hebrews tells us this: Jesus is able to save completely those who come to God through faith in him. Do you feel the saving power, the saving strength of Jesus within you this morning? Can you say with this pastor, I am saved completely. I'm saved through and through, now and forever. No matter what comes, I am safe and secure in Jesus, my Savior. Now don't miss this last lesson that we can learn. In the storm, we come to truly understand who Jesus is. In the storms of life, we come to truly understand who Jesus is. In verse 40, he asked his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Why are you so fearful?" Now think about it. These disciples had seen Jesus teach with authority that very day. Authority unlike anyone else. They had seen him heal the blind, the deaf, and the lame. They had witnessed even the demons as he testified that he was the Son of God. And even the demons had to acknowledge that he was exactly who he claimed to be. So no wonder he asked them in effect here, "Don't you have confidence in me? Don't you trust me?" And now not only have they seen Jesus do all these other things, now they have seen the very forces of nature bow before him and honor him as the one who has complete authority. Now they were afraid of the storm. But notice what verse 41 says. "Now they were terrified and asked each other, 'Who is this?'" Now they knew him better than anyone. They had walked with him and seen all these things and more that I've described. But yet they are still asking, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." Again, they were afraid of the storm, no doubt. But having now an up-close demonstration of the full measure of his power, that terrified them even more. The Greek phrase here, "they were terrified," literally it means they feared with great fear. The storm was one level and it was a big fear. They were afraid, but in realizing that they, mere men, were in the boat with someone who was not a mere man, indeed someone who had the very power of God, who they were beginning to think and realize not just a man, some sort of God, but God himself. Now they were utterly terrified, another level of fear itself. The Bible says, the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. They were beginning to learn. They were beginning to grow. When Jesus sees you through a storm, sometimes miraculously, sometimes quietly, we gain a new and deeper appreciation for who he is. We become spiritually wiser. We grow. Going through a storm, you can learn that God is faithful and you can truly depend on him. Can I get a witness today, even at home? You can depend on God because he is faithful. One of the worst storms of my life years ago, I was kneeling beside my bed praying. Tears were coming down their eyes. I literally did not know what was going to happen in my life. It was a terrible storm. I can't tell you how upset I was. But in the midst of praying and crying beside my bed, it was as if all of a sudden I felt a hand on my shoulder. And I didn't hear words that I believe were audibly spoken, but they might as well have been audibly spoken, because what I felt, what I heard in my very soul were the words, "Everything will be all right." And that fast, I was able to stand up from beside my bed. My tears dried up. My emotions were calmed. And I didn't have all the answers. "Lord, how will things be all right? How are things going to work out? What does the future hold for me?" I didn't know all those answers, but I had, to me, a miraculous peace that God was in control of my life. He would care for me as his child, and indeed, everything would be all right. What a blessing that was and is to me. Many of you can share of similar experiences of how you have learned and drawn closer to God because of the experience of a great storm. So there's a final question that Jesus asked here that we need to note. He asked the disciples in verse 40, after he asked them, "Why are you so afraid?" He asked, "Do you still have no faith? Do you still have no faith?" This morning, do you have the faith to trust Jesus through your storm? Would Jesus be asking the same question of us right now in the midst of this coronavirus epidemic? Do we have the faith to trust him? Now here it's interesting, through this violent storm and how the disciples were so shaken up by it, you'd almost expect Jesus to put his arm around the disciples and to pat them on the shoulder and console them and comfort them and you know, be what we would expect him to be. But instead of doing that, Jesus challenges them. It's almost like he says to them, I thought you guys would have figured out that in the morning when you get up, you need to put your big boy pants on. He challenges them. Why does he do this? Even with all the disciples had seen Jesus do, they were still far from being what they needed to be spiritually to be the ones who would be commissioned to take the gospel to the world. They were going to have to grow so much more in their faith and in their understanding of who Jesus is to be all that God intended for them to be. What about us? What about you this morning? To be what God wants you to be in these days, does your faith need to take several steps up? Do you need to put your big boy or your big girl pants on so that you're ready to go out there and face the world, not in fear, but in faith, because Jesus is with you? In his book, The Unnecessary Pastor, Eugene Peterson writes, "My two sons are both rock climbers. They meticulously plot their route and then, as they climb, put in what they call protection, pitons hammered into small crevices in the rock face, with attached ropes that will arrest a quick descent to death. Rock climbers who fail to put in these pitons, this protection, have short climbing careers. As Christians, our pitons or protection come as we remember and hold on to those times when we have experienced God's faithfulness in our lives. Every answered prayer, every victory, every storm that has been calmed by his presence is a pitten which keeps us from losing hope and falling. These spiritual pittens strengthen our faith. They are stepping stones toward our ultimate goal of finishing the race and receiving the crown of glory that God has for us." So this morning, do you have faith? Are you in the boat with Jesus? I pray that you will hear his words echoing across the ages. Come with me, let's go over to the other side. This morning, I want you to picture Jesus standing before you. He's holding out one hand to you, offering to take your hand. But with the other hand, notice what Jesus is doing. He's pointing to the other side. Not the other side of a lake. Not to some faraway destination on this earth in this life. But Jesus is pointing to the other side of eternity. And he invites you, he invites me to grab hold of his hand and let him lead us through this life all the way to the other side. Is your hand firmly in his hand this morning? Is your life in his control? Do you know that Jesus is your Savior and Lord, that no matter what happens in these days, you will be all right, that God will take care of you? Don't miss this in the scripture. Don't stop at the end of chapter 4, because right after the storm, in chapter 5, verse 1, we read this: "They went across the lake to the region of the Gerasenes." Now, what does that mean? That means that in chapter 4, Jesus had said, "Hey guys, come with me. We're going to the other side." And what Jesus had said they were going to do, the storm interrupted for a short while, but they got to the other side just like Jesus said they would, just like he promised they would. Jesus will do the same for you. He'll do the same for me, because Jesus always finishes what he begins. He always finishes what he begins. Jesus always keeps his promises. In the boat with Jesus, you are safe and secure. He will see you from here to the other side of glory, no matter what confronts us today. He is faithful. Trust in him. Amen. Will you pray with me this morning? And I'll give you time. Will you pray after me if what I pray echoes your thoughts before the Lord today? Lord, these are difficult days. I need you to see me through. Lord, help me to hear your voice even in the storm. Help me to draw near to you and to trust you. Teach me. Lead me. Use me and make me what you want me to be. Speak your peace to my heart. And help me to share your peace with others. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to have a hymn of response to the gospel today. And even at home during this hymn, will you pray? And as Jesus would draw near to you, will you draw near to him in these moments? If there are spiritual decisions you want to talk with someone about, please feel free to call on your church staff and deacons. We would be thrilled to talk with you during these days about your relationship with Jesus Christ. Let's sing together.
Father, you are King of earth.
nations rise and thunders roar. I will soar with you upon a storm. Father, you are King over the flood. I will be still, know you are God. I will be still, know you are God.
I pray that wonderful truth will be the reality of your life this week. Will you pray with me? Now to him, the one who can save you completely, the one who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you during these days.